Hello, I'm Patrick Pacheco. Welcome to Theater All the Moving Parts. The new musical Shucked is turning out to be the sleeper hit of the season. We gathered the show's creative team together to show you why. First, I speak with actor Kevin Cahoon, director Jack O'Brien, and writer Robert Horn, who make the corny show pop. Then I speak with lead producer Mike Bosner about how this unlikely corn-pone show, originally commissioned by Tennessee's Grand Ole Opry, steamed onto Broadway. Welcome, Kevin. Welcome, Jack. Welcome, Robert. And congratulations on one of the funniest and most delightful comedies, musical comedies, in many a decade.
What are you talking about? It's a tragedy.
We'll get to that, Jack. We know you will. And you've had some experience with tragedies.
I certainly
as
have.
As well as musical comedies.
Just getting over here today.
We'll describe it as anything but a comedy, and that it is set in fictional Cobb County, a community that's closed off from the rest of the world, which faces an existential crisis caused by the corn crops dying. Plucky heroine Maisie ventures out into the world to find a solution and meets Gordy, who is a podiatrist that she takes for a corn doctor.
Well, a fake podiatrist.
He's a fake real corn doctor.
She brings him, a fake podiatrist. He's a fake everything.
He's fake everything.
Right.
She brings him back to Cobb County, and chaos ensues thanks to Robert Horn. So, Robert, does that describe it?
Yes, that does. Bye. there is a lightness to the plot, which then becomes very, very complicated. It's a love story. It's a story about community and family. And it's a story about heroism and finding yourself and opening your heart to people who are different than you so you can grow. And we use, and corn becomes an analogy for that. It's
years in the making. It's not an exactly an overnight success. What kept you at it?
Mortgage, desperation, and I knew that someday I would be sitting in this seat with these two gentlemen. And I just knew that was going to happen.
And you were the only one who did.
That's the
I know. One of the gentlemen, Kevin, you couldn't land an audition, and you've been with it from the beginning. I mean, we were going back 9 or 10 years.
But that's true. 10 years.
Started.
Yeah.
And you couldn't land an audition for it after your stellar career in Hedwig and the Angry Inch and Lion King.
Right.
Why?
Well, I think that they had a different vision in their mind at the time for what the character was. I think they thought of him as like a Bubba, like a bigger guy that you would find in the country.
Oh, yeah.
And I, you know, I had read in the Post, the New York Post, that this show was happening, and I thought, oh, there's a place for me in that world. I just know it. And I ran into someone who was on the music team at midnight at Flaming Saddles Bar in Hell's Kitchen.
Oh,
nothing
my God.
Good happens at Flaming Saddles.
No.
And I love, you know, but
well, except for a couple of saddles. But
hey,
yes.
But this did. And he said, what are you working on? I was like, oh, I would love to audition for that. And he said, let me send a text. The next day I got an appointment and I had
and you
auditions.
Became Peanut, which is sort of the
yes.
the town.
Yeah.
Wise man.
At the time, his name was Junior Junior, and he was just the county clerk at that point, but the brother of the protagonist.
Right.
So there has been this evolution for this character that he does everything in the town. He marries people, buries people, he's got a radio show, he's the philosopher, he's the watchdog, he takes care of the animals.
Jack, I think you described him once as the Yoda of the town?
Well, I sort of stumbled on it in a rehearsal one day when I said, it's actually Robert Horn. He really is a manifestation of the writer because he's the observer. He tries to keep it all together. He doesn't have it together, but he acts as if he does. And that's sort of what Robert has done with us for all this period of time. He stitches the ideas together. And we keep moving forward and making our own discoveries.
If I may, when you write something, you sort of have an idea in mind of what you think you want. And then sometimes a performer will come in. Mm-hmm. And one of the wonderful things about Jack is that he's so open in the room and so willing to let an actor tell us what we don't know and see it in a different way. And that's what happened with Kevin. He came into the room for his audition, and all of a sudden, the idea of what we had in mind for that character vanished, and the character became Kevin Cahoon. And he got the part in the room.
What's going on, Peanut?
That Lurleen just invited me to her chicken's birthday party. Right, like I have time for that kind of crazy. And on the same day my goats are getting married?
Jack, what was that? What did you see in Kevin, particularly when it came to the Pez dispenser of one-liners written by Robert that he does in the course of the musical?
I have a theory that if you're very careful and honorable with the material and the people, it starts to tell you what it wants. Mm-hmm. And what happens is we begin to hear things together that have a cut. Now, if you take that literally and you say to the actors, what are you doing when Peanut says these outrageous things? I don't know that they know, but they believe it. Mm-hmm. They honor him as a community member. They do not editorialize. They do not, they're sometimes inconvenienced by the fact that he runs off at the mouth, but they take him seriously. And that, I followed that star thinking, oh, I think this is good. I think most of our communities that are successful are not critical. Mm-hmm. I think when we love each other and we find it amusing, you know, I mean, I had a big feeling about the tone of the show. Mm-hmm. We did not want to poke fun at people. Mm-hmm. But you see, I think these people think they're funny.
And they are.
Maybe they're not wealthy people. They don't have a lot of entertainment. They entertain each other. And I think that's part of the affection that the community has for Peanut.
Peanut, don't you think someone ought to leave here to get help?
I think if your lawyer has a ponytail on his chin, you're probably going to prison.
You mentioned Robert Horne's philosophy a little earlier as a reflection, this show as a reflection of that. How would you define it, especially in regards to the feeling behind the humor?
Well, you see, you know, we all have more than one side. And the thing is, if you are patient and if you are respectful, you're allowed to see different colors and different lights that people bring to the table. Now, this divine guy is famous for writing funny lines, and he can't stop doing it. That isn't really what attracted me to our sort of partnership, our relationship. What I loved was that underneath the wit, okay, I have to say this. People talk about puns in this script. What are there, five, four?
They're not. It's actually not a lot of puns.
There are hardly any puns at all.
Yeah.
And so it's like, and this my it's a bit bugaboo for me, because comedy has no respect. Everybody thinks it's easy. Yeah. Nobody realizes how difficult it is. Mm-hmm. And he does. So his humor always has its feet on the floor. And if you look on the floor, you see what's underneath it.
Where's your father?
Well, I tell people he ran off, but technically we lost him in a corn maze. Anyways, as a little girl, back before Mama died.
Oh, wait, your mother died also?
She was struck by lightning. Lightning was a rodeo donkey.
One of the truisms is that comedy comes out of pain.
Yes.
Robert, do you ascribe to that?
I think that's a multi-tiered answer. Jack says something that I is a mantra for me, and I'd never been able to put it into words until he said it, which is, you have to think funny. When we sit in the casting room, when we're looking for actors, it's not about somebody being funny, it's about somebody thinking funny. Mm-hmm. And I was blessed with the ability to think funny. As I think growing up, I used comedy as a defense mechanism, as a way to survive. But I also
because you were in an orphanage.
I did. I grew up as a in placement as a ward of the state, as it were, and comedy. You can use it as survival. We all decide the prism through which we want to, how we view the world and how we view what happens to us. And I just was lucky enough or unfortunate enough to be able to do it all through comedy. But the truth of it is one of the reasons, I'm going to skip around, but
sure.
You know, there was a version of the show that we did earlier, and we can get into that, did not work. And the reason it didn't work is because we didn't have Jack. And I'll tell you what I mean by that.
Wow.
Although we tried to have Jack, we didn't have Jack.
I didn't get the part. They didn't want me.
I know. Yeah.
Well, we wanted you, but things work out. Things work out exactly as they should.
Yes, they do.
Mm-hmm. When you have comedy this fast and this relentless, if you will, unless it's grounded in story, unless it's grounded in truth, unless the stakes of the comedy are the stakes of the story and not the punchline, it doesn't work. Then it's just stand up. And the show is not stand-up. So, yes, the jokes come at you fast and furious and in many different ways.
Now, I know when some of you think small towns, you think gun-toting, rusted truck hayseeds, who think liberal is how you pour your whiskey, and fluid belongs in your gas tank. But I want you to open your minds and think even smaller.
They're pushing the story, and they're always coming from what the story needs to progress in that moment. And that's what Jack O'Brien brought. Jack O'Brien, who is a master at both comedy, mm-hmm. drama, opera, ballet, pantomime, and everything.
You should see my plié.
But the thing that he kept drilling into the actors is, do not play to the audience. Play the stakes of the scene and the comedy will work.
Can we back up for a minute?
Just sure.
I want you to get to this.
Yes. Yeah.
Pardon me, but about thinking funny.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let me give you an example. And everybody can do this. Go out and get a copy of Maggie Smith doing Miss Jean Brody.
Mm-hmm.
When she did that movie, I thought to myself, they should give her the Oscar 2 years in a row because it was so amazing.
It's able to receive a proposal of marriage tomorrow from the Lord Lion, King of Arms. I would decline it. I am dedicated to you in my prime. And my summer in Italy has convinced me that I am truly in my prime.
She does not go for a joke, ever. But you can see that the woman, while she's saying something incredibly stupid, thinks, that's funny.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result, the wit bubbles up from the ground. And that, when you get that, you are in home territory.
And if I might,
yes,
one of the hardest things about a comedy like this, which is a farce comedy, is there's a missing element that changes every night, and that's the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Because an audience is a living, breathing thing. And our actors, especially Kevin, every night has to navigate the laughter because you can't ever wait for a laugh because if it doesn't come, you're mm-hmm. stuck. If you have to hear it from like a third eye, you have to hear it but not acknowledge it on the stage. And you have to know when it's about to crest to go on. And one of the joys I have of watching this show is watching Kevin, because he has the biggest some of the biggest laughs of the night, watching how he makes a connection with the audience that you can't break through. I mean, it's tight, tight, as he says in the show. And it's very difficult. It's a very difficult thing, and it's a very specific skill.
I think people in China must wonder what to call their good plates.
Kevin, did your background as a rodeo clown, when you were a kid in Texas,
true.
As a rodeo clown, tune you in, number one, to the audience, mm-hmm. and number two, to thinking funny, as Jack says?
Well, it's interesting, because I was 5 years old. From 5 to 15,
amazing.
I did the rodeo circuit. And my job as a rodeo clown was to go in between the acts uh-huh. and fill the time until they had set up, till they had filled the chutes with whatever was the next event. And I had jokes that I told with the announcer who was up in a stand.
It's
standing in the middle of a dirt arena.
To God.
In cowboy boots. Uh-huh. And we had an act.
Something else, though.
Back and forth.
Mm-hmm. Just cowboy boots?
That's why they'd run us out of town.
That's it.
But I think, isn't this interesting that all of these years later, I'm standing in cowboy boots talking to an audience relaying these jokes? It's incredible how full circle this moment is for me.
But you're not being chased by a Brahma bull.
No.
But you know what he is doing, because of when you see the show, you'll know Kevin's Peanut's brother is in a lot of pain.
Yes. Andrew.
He's going to Andrew Duran.
Andrew Duran playing
incredible. Incredible Andrew Duran. Just watching that performance is breathtaking. Mm-hmm. I'm a damn good man with a rod and a reel. If she don't want me well, if she don't want me hey, yeah, somebody well. Yeah. Ooh, oh, oh, somebody well. But he's in a lot of pain. And so what happens is his brother uses comedy to try to cheer him up, uh-huh, as well as being sort of the philosopher of the town and a very shallow, deep thinker. He uses humor to try to make his brother feel better. Mm-hmm. And that gives a reason for the comedy.
The reason for the comedy, because a lot of the part, one of the raps that the show has, and I don't think it's a fair one, is that your one-liners have nothing to do with the show,
yeah,
and the plot of the show. But in fact, what you just explained was, yes, it does.
It absolutely
does. I mean,
and it leads to your duet with Andrew.
Oh.
With Bo.
Absolutely. Hee-haw, hee-haw, there's two lions. Just one hen. Hee-haw, hee-haw, there's two roosters. Just one hen. Hee-haw, hee-haw, there's two bottles. Just one spin. Hee-haw, hee-haw, it's a fight to the finish where the best man wins. All right, I'm in. Yeah. Woo!
What carries over from Tom Stoppard and Henry IV and all the work that you've done with classical and modern theater that you could apply to this?
It's a little fatuous to do this. I deal in truth. Mm-hmm. The theater is an illusion. We know it's not real. There are people on the stage with lights on them, like this. And we go to sit and see some manifestation. The two of us are just joking up here.
You know what, it's allergy season
in
New York.
Yeah.
And we're
all
constantly,
yeah.
But this whole situation, basically, is about putting truth on the stage.
And the more truthful is, the funnier it is.
When I did Hairspray, I devised a truth and I said to the kids, write this on your makeup mirror. You're not funny, it is.
Uh-huh.
And the thing is, and somebody reminded me today that my beloved late friend Mike Nichols used to say, we must take care of our little story.
Uh-huh.
Because if you don't take care of your little story, you don't have your feet on the ground.
And when you were taking care of the little story,
yeah,
what was it that Jack brought to the little story that kind of just turned everything around and put you on the path to Broadway?
Well, art.
Art?
Heart.
Truly heart. Because I tend to love to just overwrite jokes. I mean, I love jokes. And to be honest, part of Peanut's character was, great, I have a chance to just do jokes. And it grew into something more, obviously. It's an interesting thing because we talk about this all the time. I think it's happening at the exact moment it needed to happen, where we are in the world right now. This is truly a show about community and about compromise and different ideologies coming together,
mm-hmm,
but it needed to be grounded in a place of honesty and truth. Otherwise, again, it's just farce. It's just stand up. And Jack was relentless about working with the actors, working with us, and I have to say that our composers, Brandy Clark and Shane McAnally, mm-hmm, are such a huge part of why the show is what the show is. Mm-hmm. Their sense of storytelling, there is a simplicity to this show.
Uh-huh.
In many ways, it's a deeply profound story, and it's so simple. And that's Shane and Brandy. They are able to put together lyrics in the most simple, basic way that is so profound. And they are such an important part of why the show works, why the story works, how the music brings the story through its telling.
Maybe love is like a town, is like a town. Keeps you fed, keeps you safe, keeps you sound.
Jack, how important and what was the challenge in terms of making sure that one culture, quote unquote, the elitist culture of Broadway, didn't condescend to the story that you were telling?
That's an interesting, tricky question. We knew it was loaded. We knew that we were on dangerous ground. This could be contrived, it could be satiric in a very mean-spirited way. But the truth of the matter is, we love these people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they love each other. Mm-hmm. And so consequently, it's the least cynical thing, I think, in New York right now. Mm-hmm. There's no cynicism in it at all. And you think, I grew up in Michigan. Mm-hmm. I know that. I know those people. Mm-hmm. They're people of the earth. My dad kept his hunting dogs out on a farm where Marvin and Leona Ruff, mm-hmm. they were German people who toiled the earth. Uh-huh. And we kept the dogs out there. And I spent hours out there seeing just how honest and open and sincere they were. Kevin? And they were sometimes very funny. But that's where it occurred to me, oh, they're entertaining each other. They know they're being funny. Mm-hmm. And they're comfortable with that.
Kevin, your people, your Texas people, your
sure.
Texas family.
Okay.
What is it that you love about them when you go home? When you go home and you're back amongst them and you think, yep, I'm home.
You know, there is a community. My family lived in a very rural area outside of Houston, about 2 hours. And there, this is an incredible story. I don't know if this links, but it's a great story. So I went to mail a box home here to New York. I go to this post office that's only open 2 hours a day. And the lady behind the counter is, and she's like, oh, New York. Do you live in New York? And I was like, oh, I do. And she said, oh, my dream is to see a Broadway show.
Oh my God.
Lifelong dream. And you think about these people who are simple and smart and so supportive of the people around them. Like, I know that red states get a lot of flack with LGBTQ mm-hmm. ideology and, you know, but the people in those little towns don't even think about it. Mm-hmm. It's not even on their radar.
And what would the postmistress, if I could say that word, or postmaster, or uh-huh.
postperson,
behind the desk think of this show? And especially some of the racier parts of this show.
They're so beautifully simple, the racy parts. There's nothing that's dirty about it, and there's nothing that's vulgar about it. It's just hilarious.
Well, it's honest, too.
And graceful.
It's looking life right in the face and saying, that's a fart.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the truth. And there are people at the stage door. First of all, there's a ton of young people who are coming. Uh-huh. And I don't just mean college. I mean high school. Right. They love it. But there are people at the stage door who say, I'm from Iowa, I'm from Ohio, I'm from mm-hmm. Nebraska. I have never seen myself represented.
Oh, that's great.
Without being condescended to.
Without being condescended to.
Yeah. 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 Robert,
yes.
Your grandfather had a side thing, a Borscht Belt
yes.
comedy,
yes.
right?
Vaudeville, yes.
Vaudeville.
Yes.
So Borscht Belt comedy meets Nashville.
Yeah, well, Nashville is Borscht Belt comedy, just with a twang.
Is that yes. right?
Well, when you look at...
Where are the meeting points in there?
Yeah,
Minnie Pearl.
Minnie Pearl, yeah. Uh-huh. When you who was actually an East Coast elite. I think there's an interesting connection between those worlds. You know, when the show originally started, as it's no secret, I was hired to write a musical Broadway version of Hee Haw.
Hee Haw, Hee Haw! I'm Buck.
I'm Rowan.
Hee-haw's back.
Oh, boy.
Let's go.
In rat mail.
Hee-haw! Hee-haw is a Southern vaudeville comedy. There was, in those days, there was Laugh-In, Rowan Martin mm-hmm. Laugh-In, and then there was Hee-haw. And there were a number of the Carol Burnett show. Those were all vaudeville shows. Sketch comedy with musical acts, and which is a classic American art form.
Your Majesty, may I say you look radiant?
Yes.
Yes, you may.
And may I say that your dress is exquisite?
You may.
And your hairdo is very attractive.
No, you didn't say may I.
For me, I grew up with that, you know, I tell the story, my mother was Ed Sullivan's secretary.
Uh-huh.
I grew up around that kind of comedy, around the entertainment world. And what I wanted to do with this show is take that humor, which is a dying art form, uh-huh. and find out how to interpret it for a new generation so that it can live on. Because like Kevin said, we're getting all different generations because the show is never, I do not do mean comedy. My comedy is never mean. It can be racy, but it's never mean.
Well, Tootsie certainly wasn't mean.
I don't like mean comedy.
Designing Women was never mean.
No, Designing Women was activist. It was not mean. Designing Women was very ahead of its time. But I'll tell you, you know, we did a very, very dangerous thing.
Mm-hmm.
We wrote an original musical comedy, which in this day and age...
Nobody
does it. And I understand why. This is a very, very difficult business that it's very expensive to put on a show. There are no guarantees. And so I think producers look for any kind of guarantee which they think will draw an audience, and a recognizable title will often do that.
A brand.
Right.
And so to come full circle with your question about Jack O'Brien, very few directors really understand how to mount an original musical. Mm-hmm. We're the only original musical of the season. There are other original musicals, but that mm-hmm. had a play that might have existed before, or the music is jukebox music, but we are wholly original. And that is a scary, dangerous thing to have, to start from fresh cloth.
And you have a terrific cast. What really first rate from beginning to end. You also have Alex Newell, who plays Lulu, of course, and is non-binary, gender fluid.
And every man that I meet is just intimidated. I won't change who I always been. A W-O-M-A-N. W-O-M-A-N.
Did you have any discussions about whether Lulu as a character was a woman, non-binary, gender fluid?
Lulu was always a cis woman.
A cisgender woman.
A cisgender woman. It didn't matter who played her.
Right.
The character was always a cisgender woman.
Always.
And many actresses and along the ride, we did readings, you know, with different incarnations, different script situations. It was always a woman.
It's a gay creative team. I'm not outing any of you.
Wait, what? Wait, don't tell my husband.
Could I have a taxi, please?
So there must have been a camp element, Jack, that you dealt with the material at the beginning to some extent. What role did camp, however you define it, play in terms of this show? And how did you deal with it in your collaboration with Robert in particular, and the actors themselves?
I just hate to say this because it sounds a little embarrassing, but we're very funny people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all of us, we like to be together. We make each other laugh. There isn't anybody in the show, or connected with the show, that isn't funny. And so in an odd way, it's just there like a perfume. There's a little sort of camp thing going on. And you know, maybe we bring it in with us. Maybe we have it over a sandwich. I don't know. It's there for the taking. You don't have to work for it. Everybody speaks the same language.
Yeah. How do you define camp?
Two months in the summer. I think camp is really hard to define. I'll tell you this. The show is about outliers. It is. It's about, and when I first... when I started writing the show, I knew I wanted composers that were authentic to country music, that could learn to write Broadway, and not Broadway composers who were trying to write a style of music that was not organic to them. Uh-huh. So I went to Nashville and I met with a whole slew of writers. And the last ones I met with were Shane and Brandy. And I walked into the room and here they were, two proud out country artists in a world that did not celebrate that at the time.
Absolutely.
There we were, the three of us, three queens in a room. I have to tell you, that was a big part of why I think I knew this was going to work.
You were comfortable.
I was comfortable, and we had something to say. And we let our identity, because we let who we are and our identities help guide how we tell the story. And it was very, as Jack always says, it was so organic because it's just who we are. I am a pun person, and people, and there were many times that they would roll their eyes at me because, like, enough with the pun. but there's a truth to the core of the story that came from so many of us living our honest out selves, and that who that is becomes part of the message of the show without people even realizing.
Right. Being the oldest person, not only sitting at this table, but maybe in the state. I grew up, don't forget, I was a child in the Eisenhower years.
Right.
And I do not wear this on my sleeve, but growing up as a young gay kid in Michigan in the 50s and 60s was no picnic. Mm-hmm. Could I get away with it? Could I be me and celebrate me and get away with it? Would they let me?
Mm-hmm. Right. And I think you all faced it. You faced it in the orphanage. You certainly mm-hmm. faced it in Texas. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I faced it in New Mexico and Colorado and California.
But guess what?
What?
We were good. Every one of us that's involved with this thing actually had gone through some version of having to allow themselves to be funny and creative and not be arrested or mugged. So by the time you get to this situation, you know how to do that.
This is the result, and what a great result for it 20, is.
Now, when we come together, we have a lot of history about what that was like and how difficult it was and how unpopular it was. And now it's chic. Who knew?
We have to wrap up. I'm going to put you on the spot. What's your favorite moment in the show? Or joke in the show? Line in the show?
Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
It's easy for me. I'll start.
Go.
At the very top of the show, this is how the audience learns who we are. Mm-hmm. Lulu, Maisie, Peanut, and Grandpa are all on stage, right at the top. And Grandpa says about leaving to get help, that would be a grave mistake. And Maisie says, no, Grandpa. Burying Grandma on a slope was a grave mistake. And at that moment, that's a very funny line. And at that moment, the four of them look out to the cemetery, and they do not do anything but look at that pathetic grave.
Sliding downhill.
And no one says anything. But they are in a real moment. Uh-huh. They do not milk the joke. Uh-huh. They don't even acknowledge the joke. And the audience can laugh for, 2 minutes? And they often do. They do not breathe. And it's my favorite thing because the fact that those actors understand together how to do that mm-hmm. without calling attention to it sets the tone for the evening. I love that moment. Every time I see it, I love it.
Robert?
Well, you know, that's like sort of asking what's your favorite child?
Yes.
I have so many favorite moments. I have a favorite joke, I think. One
there
of my favorite jokes. Do I give it away? I'll give it away. But there's a moment with a bad guy comes clean as being the bad guy in the town, and the town actually offers to help him. They forgive him. And he says, what's wrong with you people? How can you forgive me? Can I curse? Am I allowed to say a dirty word?
Yeah, go ahead.
He says, I'm an asshole. And the lead character turns around and says, around here, we care more about what's inside an asshole. Uh-huh. And I love that joke because there's a simpleness and a purity and a generosity to it, and it also talks about the state of the world right now and the judgments that we make on people. And it's just one of my favorite moments because it's delivered with such sincerity.
It's 3.5 years. We still laugh at it.
Still laughing.
And Kevin?
My favorite moment.
As Peanut.
As Peanut would be somebody hand me a Bible. Mm. That's the first line that I say. It's the first line within the story of our show. Our storytellers, right. Gray Henson and Ashley D. Kelly, have lines before that, but it's the first and it's the very last line. It's the bookend of the show. Mm. And it represents that our two protagonists are off on their way into their future. And it's just, and you can feel the audience, they are silent. they are silent. Somebody hand me a Bible. And then they melt and they applaud, and it's just, that's it.
That's not a joke. That's a playwright.
Thank you.
There you go.
There you go.
Jack mentioned the history that all of you brought to this, and I'm just delighted that this history brought us this moment and this show. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For joining
us. Such an
honor. Lovely to have us here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So kind of you.
Thank you. We're taking a short break. When we return, I'll be joined by Mike Bosner, lead producer of Shucked, who chats with me about how he met the challenge of bringing to Harvest a show that was anything but run-of-the-mill. We're back. I'm now joined by Mike Bosner, the producer of Shucked, which has become this season's laugh-out-loud comedy sensation.
Corn! We're talking corn. Just as sure as day that you were born.
Welcome, Mike, and congratulations. It appears you've drawn an inside straight. Aces high.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Shuck is certainly an unorthodox musical comedy. Yeah. How much out-of-the-box thinking did it demand?
A lot. It started for me with the idea that drew me to Shucked. Our two composers, Shane McAnally and Brandy Clark, who are two superstars in the country music space. And growing up in the Midwest, I'm a fan of country music more so than anything else. And I was like, why are there no big country shows on Broadway? That's such a missed opportunity. And from the get-go, I think that one of the reasons there haven't been many successful ones since The Best Little Whorehouse in Texas is because there's such a bugaboo about country music. And in a big city like New York, some people are like, country, I don't know if that's for me, that's for us. And so from the beginning, we knew we needed to approach the show differently in terms of what the title was and how we basically presented the show to the world and how we brought people in. Everything was about, we know a show does this, but what can we do that's over here? And it's kind of ingrained in what the show is in its DNA.
What was it about Shane and Brandy's music that made it, quote unquote, palatable for Broadway audiences?
Well, the joke is that I got into this because I wanted to do a country musical, and yet the score that they've written is so far beyond country. And yes, there are country elements and influences in it, but there is something inherent in their writing where they cut straight to the heart, and their storytelling in the lyrics of how they can say the simplest thing, maybe love needs a little love.
Maybe love is like a seed, a little sun is all it needs. Little rain, so it goes, and it grows and grows and grows and grows from dust.
It's said so intelligently, so succinctly, and it blew me away back when I first was introduced to it and continues to blow me away when I listen to the songs now. And I think that's what's resonating with people as they hear the score 8 times a week.
Shucked was 12 years in the making. You came into it in 2018.
Correct.
What were some of the landmines that you recognized that you were going to have to navigate?
Well, we are in an age right now doing a fully original musical on Broadway is really tough. And I think that's probably the biggest landmine we have more so than anything else.
Branding. And unbranding in this case.
Correct. Unbranding from Hee Haw and rebranding as Shucked. And what does Shucked mean? Nothing. But as we were talking about how do we position the show, how do we bring it to market, I thought our artwork was key. And we spent a lot of time developing the art and a big piece of corn. And I wanted to be very clear about the fact that if you say Shucked, you don't want someone saying, oh, is this a show about oysters? So when you see the poster, you see very clearly, oh, I guess it's going to be a show about corn.
Corn. You know?
But we also wanted to convey the tone and be light and airy and fun. And I think our art does that. I'm very proud of it.
How did you pitch it to your fellow producers who came on board and one of them being Jason Owen and AEG, the entertainment company that comes out of the recording industry.
Correct.
How did you pitch it to them? Because it's hard to wrap your head around it.
It is. I mean, Jason and I have been friends for a while, and I originally started talking to him because I was just seeking his advice. He's a big deal in the music industry. He's a manager, he owns businesses, mm-hmm. he owns a record label, and he runs all of these things. And he has kind of made a name for himself in the positioning of country music and bringing it to the world. And I thought that was very valuable insight for us. And as we were talking, he said to me one day, you know, I've never thought about doing a Broadway show, but we're so in line and, you know, about how to talk about this show and what to do with it. He said, if you ever want to do something together, I'd love to pitch in. And I said, okay, great. Let's do it together.
How did the involvement with the record company actually impact, if at all, the storytelling? What direction the storytelling went in?
That's a really interesting question. I would say it didn't as much as you would think. They've been incredibly supportive of us creating the vision for the show and realizing that vision. And they've been really hands-off until I want them to be hands-on.
And when do you want them to be hands-on?
I turn to them when I am so in it that I need kind of a, mm-hmm. you know, a check, a little. I like look to what I call my board of governors, and I look around, I'm like, how am I doing? Have I gone too far to the left, too far to the right? What do you think about this? What do you think about that? I send them things because, you know, after 30 versions of an ad that I'm seeing, I'm like, no, it needs to be more yellow, yes, yellow, bigger, you know, piece of corn, smaller piece of corn. I lose my objectivity at a certain point. And so I turn it over to them and say, what do you guys think? And Jason's always the first call. And he said, it needs this. Or he said, no, it's perfect.
Did they have any input knowing the country western market, certainly, how racy to be?
You know, they didn't. That was one of the things they loved about the show, which is how audacious we were mm-hmm. and how racy we are. And, you know, there have been a lot of comparisons made between this show and the Book of Mormon. Mm-hmm. And Book of Mormon is incredibly racy. one of my favorite shows, by the way. It's an amazingly crafted show. And this is much more, there's a wholesomeness to the humor in this show, yeah. which I really love.
My mama would always say my daddy was nothing but a scoundrel.
In what way?
Your daddy was nothing but a scoundrel.
I like to say we go right up to the line, but we never really cross it. And I think one of the things that as a creative team we've all been very cognizant of and tried to really respect is we all got into this as a celebration of country music. So we never wanted to make this a thing where it looked like we were making fun of people in rural communities. I come from a rural community. Our composers come from rural communities. And so our producing team has been fully supportive of it and have been supportive of me and our writers. And they're always looking out for that too, because that's where their core business is.
How likely is it possible to get a chart topper on the country western music charts for any song in your score?
Well, I'll let you know when it happens. We're pushing hard.
Which ones do you think are have the most potential?
We have a standout. We have a couple of standout songs in the show, but one in the middle of the first act called Somebody Will.
If you look around here, I can skin a buck and never spill my beer. I'll pay for dinner and I'll open up the door. Manners like that don't matter no more. I'm an old-fashioned guy. Up until now, I had an old-fashioned girl. I'm a damn good man, and my crops get chilled if she don't want me well.
Our leading man, Andrew Duran, sings and knocks it out of the park every night, and that is so vintage Shane and Brandy, I cannot tell you. And they wrote it in, I kid you not, 45 minutes. And Shane came back in with a guitar and he said, here's what I'm thinking, this is what the moment is. And he just played it and sang it for us and we literally jaw on the ground. We're like, this is a radio hit. Like, do we take this to Blake Shelton now? Should we get Thomas Rhett on the phone? Like, what is going on? So our hope is to do that with this music. And because of their stature in the music industry between Shane and Brandy, you know, there's a lot of interest from that community about doing a Hamilton X mixtape of the songs of Shucked, which we would love to do.
Yeah, I think I've seen your show 3 times, and that one pops as a chart topper.
Totally.
Just they're wonderful.
It feels like a country hit song.
Yeah, with all the elements, which is heartbreak, anybody gonna love me, somebody's gonna love me, it checks all the boxes.
It definitely does, and there's something fascinating that happens in that song. In the beginning, there's a lyric that Andrew sings, which was never intended to be a funny line, which is, I'm pretty good looking if you look around here. And he's actually singing from a place of heartbreak at that moment. But because of Robert Horn, and God bless him, he's the funniest man I know, one of the most skillful writers we know, he's set the audience up to laugh by this point in the show, that the audience takes it as a laugh line. And we've just embraced it at this point because we're like, okay, if they're having a good time, we're happy to let them laugh. But it's fascinating to us when that started happening and that, oh, this is the mindset we've now told the audience, it's okay to laugh, it's okay to do this, it's okay to have a good time. And
the audience will always kick your ass.
And they do.
And they do. You did a very daring thing, I suppose. When you started previews, you priced them lower than any previews have been priced, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, in a long, long time.
For a while, yes.
What percentage of your capitalization went into your reserve in order to survive?
20%.
Okay, which is relatively high.
It's relatively high. It's not exactly 20, about between maybe 17%, but that's still on the high side. And when we were talking about how to bring the show to market, I was very focused on, this is a comedy. People live and breathe the energy that's in that theater, and this place needs to be packed because with a show that is unbranded, that has nothing to sell, not a recognizable title, a recognizable star, a recognizable body of, you know, song catalog, like the Carole King musical, with nothing of that, there's gonna be some resistance, but we need people to come to this show and we need them early on. So what I tried doing is saying, how do we remove as many barriers as possible? Let's go back to the old school style of preview pricing, where it's affordable to come and get a ticket. Let's try and say not much about the show, but convey tone that it's funny, you're gonna have a good time. Oh, and it's only $49 or $69 to go see it. I'll take a chance on that. Well, the gamble ended up working because not only did we end up filling those first 3 weeks, packed to the gills, but it then gave us the biggest sales tool that any show needs, which is word of mouth.
Absolutely.
And people were loving the show. And at the end of the day, that's what we were banking on. And so I just kind of took it to the next step and we doubled and tripled down and saying, listen, we've come this far. If we're going to mount this musical because we love it and we believe in it, let's really go there and say, I'll take the hit and I'll add that additional marketing expense, which is what I call it. And we lost money for a really long time, but it was to get that word of mouth going and get the education out about the show and let people create their own narrative of what they want to say about the show. And that was the thinking behind it.
When it came to marketing, you had a big gun in Robert Horn.
Yeah.
And in your press and marketing person as well, you know, Rick Miramontes and his team, Aaron and others connected to the show. What did they contribute in terms of that crucial moment of preview, getting the word out, getting you on your feet and on your way to Tony nominations?
The amount of press that Rick and Aaron and their entire team have gotten for this little show about corn blows my mind to this day. And we were this quirky little show that just people fell in love with, and the members of the press fell in love with too.
That was another daring thing that you did, because you invited myself among them, the press corps, to come in and watch the entire show in a rehearsal room, which is never done, not in my experience.
It was another big risk, but it paid off because it got all of you guys, and thank you for coming. I got so many people who thanked me for allowing them in, and it is a sacred space that we let everyone come into, but again, we were banking on the show, and I knew the show delivered, and there's nothing like seeing that and being like, whoa, especially if you have low expectations, or not even low expectations, but no expectations. You just don't know what it is. And then you're laughing hysterically, and the songs are great, and there's these tour de force performances, and you're just like, wait, what? What did I just see?
How nervous was your creative team?
Incredibly.
I'm sure.
Robert Horn thought I was crazy. He's like, are you sure you want to do this? Even as people were walking in, he's like, are you sure? And I said, it's going to be fine. You don't have to stay in here if you don't want to.
Did you pass out prescriptions for Xanax?
Yeah, literally. No, and afterwards, they're all on board. They knew that it was the right move, and it helped set us up.
And Robert Horn, I'm sure, was just tremendous in terms of how to sell the show. Marketing-wise.
Oh, my God, yes. He's been amazing. I really feel bad for our marketing agencies because they have to compete with the funniest man on Broadway and in show business. And Robert's been not only relentless in the best possible way in terms of working on the show, and he's always looking to fix and change and all of that, but I asked him if he would be involved and help with the marketing of it because I wanted his help in that. And if you have the gold standard in Robert Horn, why would I not use that in as many places and ways as I can? And one of the things we did to convey the tone of the show in the early days, we did this whole fake quote campaign. And that idea came out of an ad meeting where the agency came forward with some ideas of what to say about the show. And I just texted Robert, who was rehearsing another show. I said, I need to meet you for lunch. And he said, great. And so we do. And I literally pulled this out for him. And in the restaurant, he wrote 30 fake quotes, of which three of them we ended up using. But we have literally 27 more that we never have seen the light of day and are equally funny. But it did the trick. And I cannot tell you to this day how many people still come up to me and say, where did you guys come up with that? And it just did enough because it didn't tell you anything about the show, but it caught your eye. And it was like, oh, this is going to be funny.
So you put your finger on it, Mike, which is producing often means this isn't good enough.
Yeah.
This isn't good enough. We got to keep doing it until it's good. You mentioned the Carole King musical, obviously beautiful earlier. That was your second musical.
Yep.
You also produced the revival of Sunset Boulevard with Glenn Close. Yep. What did you learn on those two shows that you brought to this experience?
It's funny you ask that, because on Beautiful, the thing that I learned most is start your artwork early. And I started my artwork 2 years before I knew we were going to be doing the show here, because I know it always takes way longer than you think it's going to. That was the biggest one. The other thing that I learned is what you just said, which is the job of the producer is to say it's not good enough. And not to say it in a scolding way, but in an encouraging way of we haven't done our jobs yet. And how do we bring it there? And I'll never forget when we did the Out of Town of Beautiful, they did some audience surveys, and we had, coming out of San Francisco where we tried the show out, an 89% love-like quotient. And the head of the agency, Nancy Coyne, said to me, how much of that was love? And it was 81%. And she said, not good enough. You're not going to have a hit yet. You need a 90% love. And I said, okay. And so we went back and, you know, we made the changes that we needed to. And by the time we opened on Broadway, we had a 92% love quotient in our love-like thing. And when we did this, the same thing happened. I made them do audience surveys in Salt Lake City. And we had a 94% love-like quotient coming out of Salt Lake City, but it was only 88% love. And I said, we're not good enough, guys. And luckily, I had the glorious Jack O'Brien, who was there, and we were all lockstep about everything that needed to change, that what we weren't happy with. So it wasn't that much work for me, because they knew they hadn't done the jobs in the places they hadn't. And we didn't change a lot, but the things we did change were very strategic, important changes that made it feel more monumental than it was.
Well, as you know, there are so many moving parts to a show that it's miraculous that anything gets on and succeeds as well as you and your team have done so. So congratulations.
Thank you.
And here's to a long run on Broadway and around the world.
Let's hope. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. And thank you for joining us. We look forward to bringing you more fascinating conversations with artists and professionals as New York Theater, The Fabulous Invalid, regains its invaluable place in American culture. I'm Patrick Pacheco.